Welcome to Government Week. My name is Councilwoman Mary Estime Irvin, and today I have the pleasure of having our newly elected state representative-elect, Christopher Benjamin. How are you, Chris?
How's it going? I'm great, Councilwoman. It's great to be here with you.
Good. I'm looking forward to having so much fun with you today. But before I go any further, I just want to say, first of all, congratulations. And I look forward to working with you. I'm so excited about what we're going to do. And I can't wait to have a conversation so that our audience, our resident, understand what it is that we do here locally and how you on a state level affect us locally. This morning, I'm looking at my cheat sheet here. So this morning, what we're going to do is first, we're going to start to prepare what we call soup jumeau, which is a Haitian tradition. Every January 1st, as a symbol of our independence, we prepare soup jumeau. So when we were enslaved, our masters could have it, we couldn't have it. So in 1804, we just decided we're going to have it, and we've been having it every year since. So let's just start off first before we get into all the details about what it is that we do. What I love about this is that people get to see the other side of us, that we're in the kitchen and we do regular things like regular people. So,
oh yeah, I got real pots.
Yes, all right. And you're a man and you can cook. And believe it or not, a lot of my elected male colleagues cook, and they cook very well. So I'm excited to cook with you this morning. So the first thing we're going to do is, I guess, kind of run over the ingredients informally. So we have what you call jumeau pumpkin, or squash pumpkin, I was told it's called. We have, potatoes and what we call malanga. Don't ask me how you say it in English. But most people that live in South Florida know that they can go to Presidente and Bravo, or even Publix, and just look for malanga, white malanga.
Yep.
We'll have carrots and celery and garlic and thyme, and you know, we're full of spice.
Garlic.
I'm sorry, you forgot the garlic.
Yeah. Garlic.
Yeah. Okay. And we have the Scotch bonnet and stuff. So let's get started. So we'll go into, if you get your pot, put some water in it. We're gonna eyeball everything. I'm filling mine like maybe halfway.
Okay.
And so I've already peeled mine. I've already peeled and washed my pumpkins, so I'm just putting them in the
So the big chunks like that, huh?
Right. Yeah. You can cut it up, put it in big chunks. It's fine.
I gotcha.
Now everybody does it their own way. What I like to do is I'll take two garlics that are unpeeled and put it in there to boil it while it's in there, and then I use. So we told you parsley, but I use both. I use the cilantro, but you can put parsley in there to boil with it. And then I also use one of the Scotch bonnet pepper. And what I do is I poke it so that
when
it's boiling that pear. Yeah, poke it with a knife.
Okay.
Somewhat, so that when it boils, the flavor really goes in there. Now, it all depends.
So this is a spicy dish.
Kind of.
Got a little kick to it. All right. I like that.
So I like to put, if I'm making it for my mother, I'll boil it without the salt, and then I'll put the salt later on. But I like to put salt in both. So I put a little bit of salt in it. So, you know, that it's up to you. You can choose what you'd like to do. So I put a little bit of salt. And I think we're ready to go. Ready to start it up.
All right.
Cut up.
All right, Scotch bonnet, the pumpkin, and the garlic, right? right?
I think the pumpkin, the garlic, one of the scotch bonnet, and you could put parsley. I used
to like. All right, so and a little parsley here, all right? I got the fresh parsley here.
Yes.
All right.
I like to use everything fresh. Most things fresh, yeah.
Awesome. Typically, I would chop my parsley, but I'm just going to pull it apart.
Right, and that's good enough. Now we should probably cover it for a quick bowl, and this is probably gonna take about 20 minutes.
20 minutes? All right.
Well, you know, we'll check it. So what time is it? What time do you have? 11:20?
I felt like I should have did one of those cooking shows, like prepare a pot that's already done.
And then I thought about that too, but hey, it's fun. We'll do it together. Well, what we can do in the meantime, we can start chopping up the other things, the potatoes and the malanga. You can start chopping up the carrots and the celery as we continue to talk. That's going to do most of the boiling is going to take care of itself.
All right, so while I'm chopping up, what's going on in North Miami? Or as we like to call it, NOMI. What's going on in NOMI?
What's going on in NOMI? We have a lot going on. Well, this week, like I've mentioned, we have Government Week. And so this week is a very special week where we encourage residents and businesses and our elected officials to get together and to learn about what it is that we do, and you know, and we learn a little bit more about them. So this week we have a full program of, you know, of activities where I'm reading a story time this I think tomorrow, telling the kids about the importance of being a good neighbor. We're having on Thursday a luncheon, and our keynote speaker is going to be our very own executive director from the CRA to talk about how to do business during this time of COVID.
Okay.
And then Saturday, we have a drive-through event that we have, and we're going to watch. Now my assistant's laughing because I said Wakanda, but we're going to watch Black Panther. That's Saturday at our Academy North site. And it's a drive-in. I'm excited about that. So we can still do some family fun and do it safely with our families in our cars. So that should be all that. But one of the highlights for me for this week is February 2011, this year. You're working and I'm just running my mouth, right? So February 11th of this year,
I felt like I needed a head start.
So February of 11th of this year, my colleagues and I passed an ordinance for a youth council. So I'm very excited about that. And it's going to be enacted tomorrow. So we have a couple of youth that will be, you know, our junior representatives. So I'm very excited. Where my colleagues is appointed some youth, and then our city manager, our city attorney, and our city clerk has also appointed non-voting youth. So they get to learn about government and the importance, and they get to advise us, and we get to see their perspective as youth. So that's a whole lot of fun.
I think that's awesome. I also heard that NOMI has you guys passed the an ordinance with regards to having a police oversight board.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
I saw in the news that NOMI passed an ordinance to have an police oversight board.
Yes, that's very exciting. So we, our vice mayor, Alexis May, actually sponsored that, and we supported myself and Mayor Yeneme supported this, and we thought it was very important. But I just want to highlight, in our city, we are very fortunate that a lot of the recommendations that were set in play in terms of community policing and all of that, we had already done. So this was more as you know, just to take precautions for the future. You never know. You know, we believe that most police officers do what they must, but just in case, so we have a we have passed that board, the citizen and the CID board, and I'm really excited about that as well. I'm really proud of our city and our police force. Yeah. So tell me, what are you going to be doing in Tallahassee? So, you know, for persons that are just watching for the first time, could you kind of let us know, you know, what you'll be doing in Tallahassee? And in particular to North Miami, what do you intend to, you know, to bring down to us? You represent most of District 3, and you and Dottie and Gaylor as a whole represent North Miami. So what will you be bringing to us in North Miami?
Well, you know, as a state representative, what we do is that we have our constitutional duty is to pass a balanced budget for the state. That's what our constitutional duty is. And within that, we also have an opportunity to pass policies for the betterment of the state. And speaking as such, one of the policies that I've been looking at is these police oversight boards. And I've been looking at how do we help the entities that want to have police oversight boards, make it a little bit easier for them to be able to implement those boards at the local level. And I fashioned it, and I'm looking at fashioning it kind of like when you see the code enforcement statute and how the code enforcement statute sets a parameter how for code enforcement boards, how what their powers are and the things that they're able to do as a code enforcement board. You know, I served as NOMI's, one of NOMI's code enforcement magistrates. I was inspired by that and wanted to make sure that those entities that did want to have these police oversight boards statutorily had the power to be able to do that. So without any impediments from the county or at any other local level. So that's one of the things I'm going to be working on going to Tallahassee. I also will be assisting the city with regards to its efforts to get funding for projects that you have going on in the city. I know that septic tank replacement is a big thing that's happening here in Miami-Dade County and in the city of North Miami. I'll be looking at helping the city with legislation or appropriations, and that's appropriations is the big word we use, right, in lawmaking to say you get the money. So I'll be doing things like that. So those are things some of your state legislators we do. We look at passing a balanced budget. We look at enacting laws that are for the betterment of all Floridians. And as we look at passing a budget, we also look at, in our particular districts, what our district needs are for funding. And we try to, what we say, bring back the money for those projects. So that's one of my jobs as your state legislator for District 107 is to look at the needs of North Miami and see how I can bring back money for North Miami projects to help better North Miami.
Sounds good. You know, one of the things that you've mentioned is that I'm glad you brought that up, and I meant to bring it up first, that you are a magistrate right here in our city, so we're very familiar with the residents that are right here in North Miami, so I'm glad that you mentioned that. And how long were you a magistrate here in North Miami?
For probably about 5 years.
Okay. So what about affordable housing? That is something that is near and dear to us. Another topic would be dealing with sea level rise issues. That is another flooding, you know, those type of thing, infrastructure. What can be done on a state level?
Well, what should be done on the state level is to assist the cities with funding and projects that actually deal with those issues. As relates to the issue of affordable housing, you know, we have a fund at the state level that we call the Sadowski Fund, and the Sadowski Fund was set up so that local elected officials or the local government had a pool of money that could be used to help the residents with obtaining affordable housing. And unfortunately, over the years, what has happened over the years is that anytime that we've had a downfall in the budgeting for the state and overall, we basically raid that fund in order to balance the budget. And so last legislative cycle was one of the first times in many years where we didn't do that as a state government. We didn't raid the Sadowski Fund. Unfortunately, now we have COVID. So COVID will have caused us some economic downturns. And then now I get to sit in the legislature on, that has to determine how we make up for the shortfalls in the budget. So it's going to be a tough call, but I still will be advocating that we do all that we can to meet those shortfalls without having to raid the Sadowski Fund, so the Sadowski monies can go back to the local levels to assist in affordable housing.
And you know, another thing that we have a great senior program here in North Miami. It's called the NOMI Silver Golden Program. It's a tongue twister for me sometimes. And I would love for, you know, at any possibility for us to be able to assist to get funding to grow that program. It's a great program that that we've had, but we've only been able to service our seniors 2 days out of the week. So we're looking forward. I know I'm pushing forward to being able to extend that once COVID clears up to like a five year program. Also, we have other organizations like North Miami Foundation that also services a lot of other nonprofit organizations like North Miami Foundation, SUGLA, and FUM, and others that work very closely with residents in our city. So that would be great.
So it's very important. So it's very important for the directors of those entities to come see me and to provide me with the programming for those particular programs, so that I can have an opportunity to see if I can get the appropriate appropriations or money for those programs, because we get as state legislators, in the House of Representatives, we only get 6 opportunities per cycle to be able to pass policy legislation. But the great thing is that we get an unlimited amount of opportunities to put money in the budget for our communities. And so I am willing to put as many appropriation bills forward for programs that are beneficial to our communities and that are actually making a difference in the community.
Awesome.
And I love the seniors.
Oh yeah, they're the best. They're the best. It's so gratifying to hear stories, and I love stories. To hear stories and history, and you know how things were, and you know learning from them is just so amazing, and the energy that they still have. So in February, I did we did a Valentine rendezvous, and oh my God. Those seniors got on that floor and they danced. A lot of times we think that, you know, after 65, they've lost their flavor, but they haven't. We even had a person there that was over 100 years old there. I mean, he probably had energy in all of us combined. So yeah, we cannot ignore our seniors. Is there a particular, you know what, while we're talking, did you check your pumpkin? It's not ready. I was just checking mine. It's not quite ready yet.
No, not quite. Yeah. Matter of fact, I think I'll salt the water a little bit.
And I'm cooking on a gas stove.
See, you got the best type of stove to cook on. You know, my developer built our community in such a way that I don't even think we're allowed gas stoves.
Really, yeah.
Which
this is a city. this is a, you know, an older city, so a lot of, there are still some, there are people that opted not to opted to convert to electricity. But I'm a New Yorker native, and I'm so accustomed to the gas, so I'm like, I'll keep my gas.
And all the cooking shows that you watch, they always have a gas stove and doing all kind of great things on the gas stove. I'm like, I can't do anything. I got electric.
So while we wait for that, did you already cut up all your things?
Huh?
Did you already cut up the malanga,
potatoes? I think I got everything cut up.
I'm asking you, and I forgot to cut my carrot. And you know what I normally do? And I'm looking at this. I try to be fancy because we're going to be at Zoom to our resident, right? So what I normally actually have, I have a big bowl, and I put water in it, and then I put all of the potatoes and the malanga in the water to keep the color. Because sometimes it
See, you've been watching those shows.
For the show, we'll kind of ignore that. But when you do it, if you do it on your own, after you like this delicious soup, you can know that whenever I usually cut it, I'll put it in water, put everything in the water so that it preserves the color. And then after that, when we're ready to put it in the soup, it's, all nice and pretty. Okay. So,
I need some room here for my celery.
I'm prepping for my salad now.
I cheated with the salad. I cheated with the salad. I cheated with the salad. I already have a, it's already ready.
It's already ready. Oh, cheater. I encourage us to make a salad, and I don't know why I'm washing this again because I washed it already. We're doing a salad with tomatoes and strawberries and red onions and walnuts. Put a little nut in our life, right? Is there a particular when you go to Tallahassee, is there a particular subject that is really near to your heart?
I mean, right.
Going to be focused on.
I mean, right now, I think the immediate need for our state is to really be able to get a hold on the COVID, our COVID response. You know, our numbers are spiking again because we've opened up the state. Without any real COVID protocols. So we see our numbers increasing. And as we see our numbers increasing, we also see that because of COVID, we had a downturn in our economics, which means we saw a lot of businesses close. We saw a lot of people lose their jobs, which means we saw a lot of people who no longer have healthcare and have to be on government-assisted healthcare. Which means that now is the time that we really need to be talking about expanding Medicaid in the state of Florida. I mean, before COVID, we already had 750,000 people who were excluded from having affordable healthcare because we didn't expand Medicaid. So I think that's something that the governor and his administration has to really look at as we move forward. So those are things that I will be advocating as I get to Tallahassee. A big thing that's on the radar right now too is also criminal justice reform and police reform. So we're looking at, I told you one of the things that I'm looking at in terms of police reform, but we're also looking at how do we set some state standards that make it uniform in terms of excessive force policies and things of that nature. So those are some of the things that social justice things that I'll be looking on. But I'll also be looking at economics and how the state is addressing the pandemic as it affected small businesses. And more particularly, I'm talking about micro businesses, those mom and pop spots, how they were affected by the pandemic and how do we get them back on track? Because those businesses form the cornerstone of our economic engine here in South Florida, especially in places like NOMI, North Miami Beach, and Miami Gardens. So those are my priorities as I take the helm in November.
Yeah, that's really, you touched on some key points here, and I'm glad that you're going to go in Tallahassee and really focus on those things. I mean, once when that pandemic hit all of us by surprise, One of the things that we did in North Miami immediately is our CRA, especially, and I have to give kudos to our executive director, Rasha Kamal. One of the things that we immediately did is we put out grants aside for small businesses. We had an essential grant where all of the essential workers that could stay open, we helped, you know, them out to stay alive. And then after, when businesses were able to reopen, we had what you call a jumpstart grant, where we gave small mom and pop businesses $5,000 for those that didn't qualify for the PPE. Because as you know, a lot of the small businesses in our community, and especially our Black and brown small businesses, are not always going to be able to qualify for the PPP, even though we did have some as well that did. So I'm very happy that you're considering that. We, as a city, we took the precaution very early on to make masks mandatory on going in places. And so even though the numbers are spiking, they, in North Miami, it's, you know, on the highest that I'd seen at one point was like, we had a case of 90. And I think it was over a weekend where it was Labor Day weekend, but on average, we've been having, you know, in the low teens, people that have tested positive for COVID. Even though I also pushed for us to have a testing site here in North Miami, but the county ended up doing that right here in my district. In the beginning, there were myths that, oh, this is not, can't happen to the Black community or Black people. So that was a whole education process that we had to say, look, this sees no race, no color, no gender. This can get anyone. And so that, you know,
while it can get anyone, while it can get anyone, and it does get anyone, we have to always be concerned that because of the healthcare disparities in the Black community, oftentimes when we have health issues that affect the entire populace, they affect the Black community even worse. It's a popular saying that when a country catches a cold, the Black community catches the pneumonia. So we definitely want to be able to address the healthcare disparities. And we want to give kudos to cities who are doing it right at the local level, who are trying to make sure that their residents are safe and that their residents are taking a healthy approach to how we address the pandemic. Because I mean, at the end of the day, what we are talking about is a matter of life and death, you know, and the way that we address, the way that politicians address these issues or lawmakers address these issues, we have to always have our sight towards the fact that one of our jobs is to protect our residents, to protect our citizens. And how we address the pandemic makes a difference in how we address that particular duty that we have.
Correct. So I didn't tell you one of the reasons why I chose Soup Jumu. Well, to make Soup Jumu with you, outside of it being a traditional Haitian soup, October is Vegetarian Month. And people that are close to me and work with me know that I'm a vegetarian and I was born and raised a vegetarian. So this month is October month. So normally this soup is done with a little bit of red meat, but we're not gonna do the meat part. And it's still gonna be as tasty, and you're gonna be my witness after this is all said and done. And you're gonna let me know. Have you ever had soup jumu before, by the way?
I've never had soup du jour, but I can't wait to taste it. And so your recipe will be the first comparison I have to when I have soup du jour somewhere else. I'm like, I don't know, this don't taste like Mary's.
Well, how about this? How about after it's done, I'll say some, and I'll taste yours and you taste mine. How about that?
Great. That's a plan. That is a plan.
I'm gonna check mine again to see. I guess I'm just anxious, right? But you might want to check yours. I check it with a knife. I just go in and check it with the knife to see. If it's still tough, then it still needs to boil. Mine still needs to boil. How does yours look?
Yeah, mine still needs to boil a little, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to focus on
But actually, there's already a great aroma to it already. There's already a great aroma to it already.
It's already in what? Yes.
Smells great. Yes.
Can't wait for you to have some. Last year, for the first time, we had a Souk Jumu inaugural celebration pre-COVID. We actually had it outside, and it was so beautiful. And one of our guests was actually Calvin Hughes from Channel 10, and he enjoyed it. So. And we also had our board member, Dorothy Mendingall, show up.
The Queen.
Commissioner Daniel Levine Cobble showed up. Commissioner Monestine was there. Who else was there that I can remember? We had a couple of guests there as well for that day. So we'll see what happens. I don't think we'll be able to have one in person this year, but we'll do something somehow. So tell us a little bit about you and your family, Rep.
Well, I'm a native Floridian, born here in South Florida. I was born in Broward County. So I like to tell people, you know, I'm Broward County, born and bred, but I'm made in Dade, because I did all my schooling here in Miami-Dade County. I did my undergrad studies in political science at South Florida's historically Black college, Florida Memorial University, where we lift every voice and sing, home of the Fighting Lions. And I went to law school then at St. Thomas University, which is actually like right around the corner from Florida Memorial. After I graduated from law school, I worked for a brief moment at the court in the family court division as a case manager. And during law school, actually, I worked as a certified legal intern for the public defender's office. And I did that for an entire year, carrying my own caseload. So when I finally got barred and I decided to open up my own law practice, I already had like three areas of law under my belt. One of my emphases in my law practice was to offer services to those folks who couldn't afford the high priced attorney's fees and didn't qualify for legal aid. So that's in the populace of people that I've targeted with my law practice, in hopes that I can provide the greatest amount of good to the greatest number of people.
So you've been doing public work for a very long time.
Yeah, you know, I've had the opportunity.
Officially.
I'm just doing it now in an elected capacity. I've served on a lot of boards.
Yeah.
I've been appointed to a lot of boards from the state throughout the local governments. So this was my opportunity to serve as an elected official at the state level and to elevate my advocacy for the people that I've been serving for the last 20 years.
So talk about the state level. When are you going to be sworn in?
I wish they would tell us this COVID has everything, seems like COVID has everything so out of whack. We're told that the swearing in would be the week of November 16th and most likely on Tuesday, November 17th. They have not yet decided whether we're going to have a physical swearing in Tallahassee or whether we're going to have a swearing in by Zoom. So my hope, of course, is that we have the physical swearing in Tallahassee and we abide by all the CDC rules with regards to social distancing and wearing our masks. But you kind of want to see the pageantry of the swearing in ceremony rather than having to do it by Zoom.
And I know the feeling. Tonight at 7 o'clock, my State of the District for District 3 is going to air. And this is my very first one. And I've had to do it virtually because of this COVID. So I hope by within a month or so that your wish to be in person is possible. But
you know, if we can't, we'll do it locally, and we'll make a fete of it, as we say in St. Martin. It'll be a big fete.
Yeah.
You know, because my family's from St. Martin. My father is from St. Martin.
Okay.
on the French side.
Okay.
In a little city called Grand Cas.
Do you speak any French, by the way?
You know, years ago, when I was young in high school, he bought me an at-home course that had the cassette tapes and everything to help me learn French. But I could only pick up, I only picked up a few things, only a few things remained with me from that course, you know? So I could say...
Right?
unfortunately, the course didn't have bad words, but I can say I can ask questions like my name. I can say stuff like my name is, you know, and I can say ask for things like, are you single?
Can you still say it now?
Let's see. Je m'appelle Christopher Benjamin. And what was it? Êtes-vous célibataire?
Oui, je m'appelle Marie-Estimée Hervet, et oui, je suis très célèbre. I'm single, very single, very single. But anyway, going back to what we're talking about, let's bring it back home. So one of the things that are important in Tallahassee is being able to work across the aisles. So, you know, what have you done? Have we already spoken to some of your colleagues that may not be the partisan that you are? Have you spoken to them? What is your plan? How are you going to work across the aisle without compromising your value, and how will that benefit North Miami?
I haven't, to be honest, I haven't had, well, do we put out everything in there now? If the pumpkin seems
no,
right?
Not yet. Not yet, because we...
All right.
Okay. Oh, it's soft enough.
So I really haven't had an opportunity. Yeah, mine's there.
Okay, good. So you know what we'll do?
I did smaller chunks. That's what happened. I cut them up into smaller chunks.
Oh, great. Oh, good for you. That was smart. What you will do is, I don't know, we'll put it in the blender. We'll have to blend it first.
Oh, okay. We're blending stuff. Okay.
Yeah, that's what the blender's for.
Oh, that's right. I forgot. I almost forgot about that.
Yeah, there you go. I'm just gonna put it in the blender now.
So the carrots and the potatoes and the celery, those things all go in the blender.
Right. No, not in the blender. So we're gonna put the pumpkin in the blender, and then once we do that, when that's going, then we'll put the potatoes and the malaga in first. You don't want to put your celery and your carrot first so that it doesn't overcook.
Okay.
Put that a little bit later on.
Okay.
And then what I do is I put, you know, the garlic that we put in there to boil, I put it in the blender. And I don't put the parsley. Don't put the parsley in. I want to make sure that you can still leave the parsley in the water. And what I'm going to do is we're going to put just a little bit of water in the blender, cold water in the blender. Just enough so that, not too much. Did I lose you?
No, I'm here. I was concentrating. trying not to get the parsley, trying to get the pumpkin out without getting the parsley too.
Okay. No, you didn't put the parsley in the blender, right?
No.
Yes, please.
Don't just a pumpkin.
Yeah, just a pumpkin. Let me know when you got everything in the blender. And you would just put some water just slightly above it, above the pumpkin. And so you could, and then we can blend. I mean, we can blend it. If you have a really good blender, it should, you know, it should really puree real quickly. And then let me know how that comes out. In the meantime, what I'm going to do is I'm going to now put the potatoes that I cut up. And the malanga that I cut up. I'm gonna put the water back on, and I'm gonna use that water to boil, you know, to boil everything in. And then at this point, you could put the thyme. Am I going too fast?
No, you put the thyme in after you put the potatoes in.
Right, after the potatoes and the malanga, put it in the water. I'll put the thyme in there. And I do a little something that the leaf of the celery, if you still have that, I use that as well as flavor to boil it in.
You're saying that the leaf of the celery?
Right. So yeah, put the leaf, I use it as a herb. Fresh leaf, if you happen to have it. Sometimes you buy the celery and the leaf is still there, other times it's not.
All right, so next goes my potatoes.
Did you already, are you done with blending?
Yep, it's pretty blended.
Okay. Let me know when you put everything else in the pot so that we can put our pureed pumpkin in.
Looks like I got everything in the pot.
Okay, did you already put the pumpkin in? You're pouring that in now?
Now we stir in the pumpkin, okay.
Right. So put all the ingredients that I mentioned before. Now we'll put it in, and I usually stir it as I pour it in. You may want to put a little bit of oil, just a tad bit, not much.
I can't wait to taste it.
Yes, it actually looks pretty good. So now we're practically almost done. It has to be do a little bit more boiling because we want the potatoes and the mama got to cook.
Did we do the time?
In the meantime, I'm sorry?
The time. Did we put the time in there too?
Yeah, I put the time in there as well. And honestly, I like to sometimes I put two Scotch bonnet. So there's one that boiled with the pumpkin, and sometimes I'll take another one and I'll put it because it'll have a fresher taste. I kind of, but that's up to you. So I poke it and put it in there. So I'm gonna wait for it to boil some more. And when it does, then I'll put the carrots and the celery. And then, but before that, we should probably season it. So you can put salt to taste.
Some salt, some pepper.
Some salt, pepper, seasoned salt.
Oh, it's Caesar salt.
Yeah.
A little seasoned salt.
I reinforce it with garlic. With garlic powder, onion powder.
Oops. Speaking my language, I got all of that over here. Speaking my language.
Onion powder, a little bit of black pepper.
That's my garlic powder. I'm gonna get some help from the Caribbean all spice.
All spice, okay.
Man, this smells good.
Mm-hmm. I tasted mine a little bit. I mean, obviously needs to boil it. I was just tasting for the spice level to see. But I'll let it boil again so I can get a truer taste of the spice.
All right.
And I'm going to cover it so hopefully it cooks a little faster. Oh, you know what we didn't talk about today, Rep, it's a very important week. Today is the start of early voting. And I just want to make sure that everyone that is on, that's watching, takes the opportunity to go and vote from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. I know here in North Miami, you can vote at the North Miami Library. And the lines are long because people are just very determined to vote, which is a good thing for us to, you know, exercise the right that we have to vote. And that this is one of the things that we're trying to educate civic engagement and stuff in our community this week with Government Week. And I'm so happy that it's happened to fall in the week where we actually are voting. So I voted this morning bright and early. So if you haven't voted, please go out and vote. Not talking to you, Rev, I'm talking to everyone else that's listening. I'm sure that you're going to be voting.
Also, those people who obtained a mail-in ballot, if you haven't already sent your mail-in ballot in, you can take this opportunity to go to one of the early voting places and drop your absentee ballot off there. All right? It's a great way to make sure that they have your absentee ballot. Also, make sure with the absentee ballots that you sign the back of the absentee ballot so that you have an effective vote. All right? And you cast it timely. So again, it is early voting. So we want everyone to go out and early vote. This is an important election. It may be one of the most important elections of our lifetime. So please go out and vote. Make your voices heard.
Yes. Extremely important. Now mine is bubbling up. How's your soup coming up?
Oh yeah, it's bubbling.
Another 10 minutes, it'll be fine. This is my first experience doing this live, as it is yours. So I thank everyone for their patience as we're watching this and going through this. I don't know if I mentioned to you, but one of the ways that we eat this soup is with bread, typically Haitian bread, but honestly, any bread that you'd like probably would be fine.
So,
smells really good. What is that?
That's my salad.
Oh, I need to cut my strawberries.
I cut my strawberries, some tomato. Yep. I told you I cheated. I just had to add the tomatoes and the strawberries. And I got some walnuts. I got walnuts, but my walnuts are glazed, so they have a little sweetness to them.
Oh, okay.
Kind of complement the strawberry.
Yes. So obviously you can have whatever seasoning you like. Believe it or not, whatever dressing you like. Believe it or not, I like it with just lime. Sometimes.
You know, my dad used to cook a lot of soups for us on the weekends. And this soup smells like that. It smells like dad in the kitchen on a Sunday cooking soup. I would typically had chicken in it. But it was always
I thought about that. I thought about having maybe grilled chicken. Maybe that'll be something we'll do next time. But then I said, in the spirit of vegetarian month, you know, let's just keep it vegetarian.
There you go. Awesome.
Oh, that's the reason why. So I'm crossing. My salad is practically done. Only thing I'm going to do is I'm going to squeeze a little bit of lime. Salad. I'm going to check on this again to see the level of the potatoes are cooked. I don't know. Did you taste your soup yet to see if You season it to the level that you like.
Yep.
You take the peppers in.
It's pretty good.
In a couple minutes, we'll be able to add the carrots and celery.
And Councilwoman, I hate to cook and run.
Okay.
But I have another Zoom with the good state senator Jason Pizzo.
Excellent. Well, I'm glad that you brought him up. We're going to cook tomorrow, but we're having breakfast tomorrow. And I saw him,
yes.
So we're having Jersey style breakfast. So we'll see what that's like tomorrow. But you know what?
Right.
It was again, thank you, Rhett, for being here. It's pretty much done. The only thing that needs to happen is you need to, in a few minutes, just put your carrots and the celery. And then another nice trick that if you have a little bit of lime, you can squeeze a little bit of lime for acidity and put it in. And that's it.
Hey, it was great cooking with you. My soup tastes good already, so I can imagine how it tastes again in a couple of minutes. So
yes.
I'll tell Jason you said hi, and you can't
Please.
Wait for tomorrow.
I'll see him tomorrow.
Right.
Tomorrow, and thank you so much, and I look forward to working with you on in the state and working for you for the residents of North Miami. You have a beautiful day. And I just want to tell you publicly my condolences to you and your family. I know that we are all praying for you and your family, and I appreciate your strength, you pushing through, irregardless of what's going on. You're just moving and moving and moving. I just want you to know that my family and I are praying for you, and I know that all will be well with you. Thank you.
Thank you, and have a great day.
Have a great day. So I'm just going to thank you for you that have signed in. I mean, we're almost done, but this is it, really. I'm just putting carrots, the celery. I had a great conversation with our newly elected rep. And I look forward to seeing you guys for the rest of the week. Please look at our calendars to see the great events that we have.